Okay, so who else again that has just come? Hello, Alvin, Amanda. I think I haven't really greeted you. Michael also, Rachel, Selena, and Wong Yeo. Okay, I hope everybody are well. We're gonna go into this one on the second part for this one. I'll try to finish these things first. So last week we have covered the mathematical modeling. Okay, we need to recap a little bit, go back into the mathematical modeling, how basically you need to be able to make a simple dynamic law model, and then we also go into the degrees of freedom. Okay, so we need to know where our problem is, what variable is, and then is our solutions are unique or not. We need to know the degrees of freedom. Then after we know the degrees of freedom, then we go and talk about the linearizations of the nonlinear function. So how do we linearize nonlinear functions, and why do we linearize nonlinear function? So why did we linearize nonlinear function, for example? Taha, you may want to answer. Why do we linearize nonlinear functions on that regard, for example? You want to try to answer why do we bother to linearize nonlinear function? You see, Clarence, anybody wants to try why we linearize nonlinear function? Guys, I'm asking you a questions that, oh well, it's easier to solve, yes, because if you linearize that thing, then you will be able to get an explicit functions, okay, an explicit ODE that can be solved easily using a Laplace transform. So the reason why we linearize is because the control theory has been more developed for the linear ordinary differential equations. So if we have that thing linear, then it will be valid for the regime where you basically take that linear value around that value where you take that linear functions to make it linear. Okay, so yes, you make your life easy, but it's just for the simplifications of your concept, okay, so that you go and you are able to basically get the linear ODE. With the linear ODE, you will be able to use the Laplace transform. So with the Laplace transform, you can deal with the transfer function. So the transfer function will be what we discussed today. Okay, so this will be the transfer function. So this, with these things, then it will be easier for you to grasp, to have an understanding of how process control is being done in the simplest way, without going into the nonlinear ordinary differential equations. Okay, but remember that in real situations, okay, you need to use the solve nonlinear ordinary differential equations. If you really want to approximate, if you really want to know how the behavior, the dynamic behavior of your system. So how do you do that thing? Is basically using a MATLAB, where basically you code everything into a MATLAB, including the ODE solver, including the controller, including the differential equations you put it in. That's what I'm giving to you in the project one. That's basically how you solve the nonlinear ODE using a MATLAB, using an Euler method where you put in a proportional controller and proportional integral controller into your control system. Okay, another way you do that thing is basically using an Aspen Plus dynamics. So first you create the Aspen Plus simulation first, the steady state version. After that, you convert into Aspen Plus dynamics. Within the Aspen Plus dynamics, you can install every controller that you want. Then you can explore what happens if any of the fit, any disturbance is applied into the system. For example, if you increase the fit rate by 10%, you increase by 20%, you increase the fit composition, you reduce the fit composition, okay? How does it affect your the dynamic response. So these are, in reality, you will have to use a simulation tools to be able to understand how you can design and implement a particular control structure. Okay, so that's what I'm giving it to you. I'm giving you the plant-wide process the plant-wide control, and also the simulation tools in terms of the tutorial. So now we are ready to go into the transfer function after we understand what the Laplace transform is. Okay, so we will define what transfer function is, develop the transfer functions of simple processes, determine the gain of transfer function, the order of transfer function, and the zeros and poles of transfer functions. Which one do you guys like in life? Do you guys like to learn so many theory, or you just like to go into the practical situation to solve the particular problem? Which one do you want in life, actually? If you want to go deeper into the theory, or you just, sir, I don't really care about so much theory. I just need the tools. You give me the tools for me to really solve the problem. Practical. So there you go. So that means your project one and your Aspen Plus dynamics tutorial, that will be the best things that will set you apart as a chemical engineer. Because if later on somebody invite you, for example, you see, you may be interested to, somebody will ask you, for example, a consultant will come to you. You see, I want you to design a distillation column that can separate azeotropic mixture. Okay, this is the specifications. So, and then I want you to design also a control structure for that particular distillation column. I want it to be stable, such that whatever the disturbances that you apply into that particular process, it will not affect the output of the process. So that's how you're gonna do. You're gonna put it into the Aspen Plus first. You do all these things, and then after that, you install everything. But of course, the simulation is not gonna be easy as well. It's gonna take some time for you to put in. Okay, that's why you need those independent learning time for you to be able to put it into the real things. Because to me, if the lecture is only talking about the theory, okay, you catch the theory, but if you don't apply, you don't put it into the perspective, then that will not be used. And to me, paper like these papers, like the one that Dr. Kong has, he's my student actually, is really good one, because this will teach people how to do this thing. So how you put the level control, how you put in the flow control, okay, and then how you add in a cascade control or other things. So that are the thing that are more important is, to me, instead of learning all the theory in here, more important thing is to have the hands-on experience on those things. Okay, so we're gonna talk about the order of the transfer function, determine the zeros and poles of the transfer functions. Okay, so you go and look at the figure one in here. For example, we have an input or on in the output. So this system is called the single input and single output, because you only have one single input and one single output in here. This single input single output system can be represented by a linear or linearized and order differential equation in the form of equation one. Okay, this FT in here is the input, and your behavior, dynamic behavior of the system, is represented by this YT in here. Okay, so your independent variable in here is your T. Your A and B are the constant coefficients. So if you assume that the system is initially at the steady state, remember that when you, after you linearize, then you define your differential equation in terms of the deviation variables. Okay, deviation variables meaning that with respect to the deviation from the steady state value. Okay, so in this regard, we can take that y equals zero, and then including all the first derivative, the second derivative, and the end derivative will be equal to zero. So if we do take it like take Laplace transform for these things in here, okay, or we take Laplace transform for these particular things, then the second term, the third term, and the other terms will be equal to zero, so that we can have this term easily. Therefore, if we take Laplace transform of this equation number one, this will become like this. This will have a linear form. Okay, So therefore, what you can do is you can say you know that YS term in here come out on all the terms in the left hand side. Therefore, you can separate YS with respect to FS. So this is something that we call the transfer function, okay, which is defined in terms of the simple algebraic form, which relates the output of a process to its input in the S domain. Now, the transfer function of a seesaw system can be represented using the following block diagram. So remember that we are dealing with the in the Laplace domain, so it's the S domain, meaning that the input in here is S, FS, and this one is represented in terms of the capital F, okay? And then this one is represented in terms of the capital Y. So there is an input and there is an output. And in this slide, we cover the other system. This one is called the multi-input single output system. So you can see that it is represented by 2. In here is 1, right? So meaning we have 2 inputs on the right-hand side. If we take the Laplace transform, then we will end up with 2 transfer functions in here. The first transfer function in here, the second transfer functions in here. Okay, then we can draw the block diagram of the multi-input single output system in terms of this particular block diagram. Okay. Then you can extend this yourself. You can draw a block diagram for several input single output system, which essentially just adding extra input and adding extra transfer functions. So the transfer function, it basically allows the development of a simpler input output model of a process. It describes completely the dynamic behavior of the output when the corresponding input changes are given. Okay, and if we take the inverse back in terms of the Laplace transform, then we can obtain the response of the system. However, if we want to determine the transfer function of a nonlinear system, first we need to linearize that around the steady state and express that in terms of the deviation variables. So everything that we have talked around the linearize need to know that that is only valid around the steady state value where we took our linearized function around. Okay, if we operate far away from that steady state value, then the linearized model will not be valid anymore. So these are an example. So derive the transfer function of for liquid tank system. So the first thing that you do is develop the model, which is this one. Again, check the unit. Okay, I'm not gonna go into the units, but let's construct the model in terms of the deviation variable. So we took it at the steady state value. This is why we have this subscript S at steady state. Then we subtract this one from the first equation. So we have this one, okay? Then we define the deviation variables, where the one that we give this this dash in here, okay? That's H minus HS, Fi is Fi dash is Fi minus Fis, F naught mean FO at steady state. And then we assume that the system is initially at steady state. Therefore, H, the value of the H at zero is equal zero. Okay. So as a result, this one is actually supposed to be H and then dash, actually supposed to be H and then dash zero. It's supposed to be equal zero. Because at equal zero, the deviation variable of this supposed to be equal to zero. Okay, guys. Then you take the Laplace transform. If you take the Laplace transform, you will get it equal to this. Okay. Remember that you have this A in here and then this. These things, if you take Laplace transform, it become S, become capital H, and then you have this dash S, okay? Then you can put in like this. So then you can draw in the block diagram in here. The formula in here is just helping you to basically get how this was done before, okay? How this becomes this. how the Laplace transform of this becomes this Laplace transform in here. The example two. So if we are asked to develop a transfer function for the following tank heat reactor, where we have a temperature that comes in, and then we have this flow rate that comes in, we have the volume, we have the heat input into the tank, and then we have a temperature. In here, because this is steered, meaning that whatever the temperature that we have in the tank is equal to the temperature of the stream that comes out from the tank. Okay. Then how do we develop the model? So the mass balance that we use is this one. D rho V per dt is equal to Wi minus W. And if we assume that V is constant, meaning that there is no accumulations, right? The V is constant. Then the only way to achieve that thing is if your flow rate input is equal to the flow rate output. Okay, so this one is something that are that must be satisfied because we assume that V is constant. Then we go into the energy balance. Again, if we want to take an easy way, then that will be specifying that T ref is equal to zero. But we don't necessarily have to specify that T ref is equal zero, because if we assume that this WCP T ref is almost equal to the WCP T ref in here, then they cancel each other in here. And then the derivative of a constant temperature will be, with respect to time, will be equal to zero. Okay, but we can simply just take it is equal to zero. It doesn't really matter whichever option that you take. Okay, then we assume also that we know that this rho V and Cp is a constant, so it can be taken out of the derivative. The next we divide by WCP, then we will have this. Next we define two variables, which is the time constant. Okay, this will be the rho multiplied by V divided by the flow rate. So this one's supposedly mass flow rate, I think. And K is equal 1 divided by mass flow rate multiplied by the heat capacity. If we design this, if we define these things in here, then we will get these equations in here, which is an equation 7. Okay, then we construct the model in terms of the deviation variable and assume that the system is initially at steady state. Okay, if next what we do is we take the Laplace transform, then we have the two transfer function. The first transfer function is related the output with the temperature of the inlet. The second one is relating the temperature with the heat that is put into the system. So if you go back again and then check the system, there is two ways that this one, there is two contributors to this temperature. The first one is the temperature of the inlet, and then another one is the heat that we put in into the system. So ideally, the one that you will adjust is this one to control the temperature of this one, because this Ti in here will be more or less is the disturbance variable, something that you may not necessarily be able to control. Okay, next we move on into the multi-input, multi-output system. Imagine in here is represented by the two output and the two input in here. So this YIT is a function of these two, and Y2 is also a function of these two. Therefore, the derivation of the transfer function, if you follow the same way that has been developed for the previous derivations, you will get this equations in the Laplace domain, these two equations. And we can draw the block diagram. In here, the thing that are important to note is that this capital G, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, I, G in here. So the I in here refers to the output, and J in here refers to the input. what you can do in here is also redraw the block diagram in a different configuration, because this is showing you one ways of drawing the block diagram in one configuration. Okay, this is a so-called 2x MIMO process. Okay, so far anything that you go, this is a bit quite straightforward, right? It doesn't have many other difficult concepts for you to understand, I think, on that regard. Okay, now if we go and inspect into a transfer function, then we can define the term that is called the poles or zeros of the following transfer function. So the numerators in here, the one on the top of your of your division line in here, is called the QS, which is the numerator. This is zeros, and the one on the denominators in here is the poles. Okay, so we have three transfer functions, and we are asked to determine the poles and zeros of the following transfer function. So for the first one, the poles in here is at s equals zero. Okay, what you need to do in here is equalize this value equal to zero. So what value will make this this term in here equal to zero? So that means this one is an s equal to negative 1/3. For the zeros, what values that makes this term in here equal to zero, which is a minus half. Okay, the same thing with equation 9 and equation 10. So you have this one is zero twice, and then you have minus 1 divided by 5, and then your zeros in here is equal to none, because this value can never be equal to zero. Okay, everybody will I think this one is something that is quite straightforward from the mathematical form. Then you will ask me why we go and care so much about the poles and the zeros, because the poles of a transfer function determine the type of the response of the system. Okay, so we have six different cases in here where the poles are at the origin for case one. The case two is negative real poles. So case three, positive real poles. We have imaginary poles, complex conjugate poles with negative real part, complex conjugate poles with positive real part. So for poles at the origin, what we will have is, if we only have a single pole at the origin, then our output will be constant with time. If we have two poles at the origin, that value will increase from zero to a certain value. So this one is implying a linear increase with respect to time. If we have two poles at the origin, how about the negative real poles? If we have a negative real poles, then the output will decrease with time. Okay. What will happen if we have a positive real poles? If we have a positive real poles, we will have a function that will increase in this manners with time. Case four, if we have two imaginary axes, okay, we have the complex something on the complex plane. We have this one in here, and then we have this one in here. So this is what we will have, something that are looks like a sinusoidal wave. Okay, the output is basically fluctuating with time, fluctuating regularly with time. If you have the complex poles with negative real part, so this imaginary poles, this one is where it sits on the imaginary poles. Okay, so in here, it's basically sitting, it has the negative real part in here, and it's also had an imaginary part in here. So something that will fluctuate but decay with respect to time, increasing time. So the complex, we have another aspect where we have the complex pole with positive real part, where it's basically increasing in fluctuation manner with time. So what are the conclusion, guys, from here? So if you are dealing with a control structure, you want the value of the variables to be bounded, meaning it will not increase with time, but it will reach a certain value that are defined at infinite time. Okay, so this one will be something that you will not consider, so because this one will keep on increasing, so you will have problem if you are dealing with the control structure. This one is okay because this decay with time. Okay, this one is also you will have a problem because it will increase with time. This one probably will be okay as long as the value in here is just fluctuating within a certain limit that can be tolerated by the system. This one will be okay because it decays to zero. This one is where you will have a problem as well because it will increase with time. Therefore, what is your conclusion? Your conclusion is that all processes that have poles with negative real part are stable, but all processes that have repeated poles at the origin or poles with positive real part are unstable. Okay, because imagine if you have something that keep on increasing with time, especially if that is a temperature, for example, then that may have a catastrophic effect to the system because the temperature cannot be increased. It has to be bounded within a certain value. Okay, so then in here, in the next example, we are dealing with we are given a four different transfer function. Okay, we are being asked to identify the process that are unstable. So if I inspect these things easily, then I will see that I have a repeated poles at the origin for this one. So this number 12 will be unstable. Okay, the one in here, I know that the poles will be negative. So this will be stable. Okay, in here I will have something that are positive, so this will be unstable. This one is negative, so this will be stable. Who agree with me on this regard? Do you think I'm correct or not? There is no answer is given in here, so you guys need to go back and refer back in here again, try to check it again, how you judge the system based on what has been described. Okay, the last slide that we will discuss for this theory part is that the steady state gain. Okay, steady state gain K is defined as the ratio of the output variable change to an input variable change when the input is adjusted to a new value and held there, thus allowing the process to reach a new steady state. Okay, so calculations of K from the transfer function model. So these are the definitions. And then what you can do is you can define this K from your transfer function by taking the value of S as it approaches zero. Okay, so that's what you need to do in here. In here is giving you one particular example of what happens with the steel tank heating systems with a constant hold up of V in here. So if you put in S equals zero in here for this particular steady state gain, it will be equal to this value in here. Whereas for this one, that will be equal to K. Okay, so anybody has another questions on the particular theory that we discuss in here? It looks quite straightforward. So this thing is basically just giving you an overview into the transfer functions and how you're gonna use the Laplace transform to be able to find any particular contributions from your input variables to the output variables. If no questions, then I will continue into my next slides. Okay, this one is probably a bit long, so I will not try to cover everything by today, but rather I will try to go slow and point out what I can the important essence from these slides. Okay, like I mentioned you again, plane wide control fundamental is something that is important for you to have as a chemical engineer if you are considering something that is practical. So right now, the only tools that are available for you to do that thing is basically using a MATLAB by if let's say you want to connect the continuous steel tank reactor with the distillation column, then what you can do is basically installing or developing a mathematical model for the continuous steel tank reactor, and then you develop a model for the distillation column. Okay. In the past, if you are doing it 20 years ago, then there will be no software that can do a control simulations for you like Aspen Plus Dynamics. But now, because of the rapid development in the technology, that becomes possible for you to use an Aspen Plus Dynamics. But for those who would like to understand how the simulation is done in reality, you need to be able to understand MATLAB and play with the MATLAB and develop your own code. Okay, for those that care so much more about I don't really care so much about what happened inside, but I care so much about what will happen to my system, then you go and apply using Aspen Plus Dynamics. Whichever that you want to choose does not matter, but those two are the tools that Louis Ben is using. So Louis Ben is very famous in Lehigh University. He's basically a professor that are well known for this plane-wide control fundamentals. Okay, so when we are talking about the plane-wide control fundamentals, we want to learn some heuristic considerations to create effective control structure. Heuristic is something like a guide. Okay, you have something like a systematic guide for you to tackle, to follow with, to create an effective control structures. Then you will ask me, sir, how did I get that guide? That's because those people that are doing that, that are developing or doing a research in this particular area of the process control, those people are normally a consultant for the industry. So people, big people like Professor Louis Ben, he also not just developing a textbook only, but he also applied his knowledge into the industry. He developed that process control, he came from industry, he worked in industry for 2 years, 3 years, okay? And then later after he go back again to his university when he teach, he is asked to basically troubleshoot a problem in industry as well. And this is where it's become important, become interesting, because the research that are applied into the real conditions, then that's going to be interesting. Okay. Then we be able to describe the steps that need to be carried out to develop effective plane-wide control structure. And in here, the scope is limited to design a control system that provide basic regulatory control. Okay, we will not go into the advanced control structure that will be able to reduce the level of the disturbances as minimized as possible. That will be the subject of a research paper that my students are doing at the moment. Okay. So these are particular examples. So a control system should be designed from the viewpoint of the entire plan. So how you would be able to effectively regulate the control for the whole plan that consists of different unit operation. It's not just basically combining the control system of each individual unit. A typical plan will be divided into reaction and separation section. So for example, if you are dealing with this one, the easy one is that for the methanol production, we know that this one is the reactor system. The other one is the separation sections, right? We know in here that we have the extractive distillation column. In here, we have in methyl acetate and water. And as a product, we have a four products in here. And then we have a separation column. The first extractive, this one is a simple separation column that separate methyl acetate and methanol with respect to the water and acetic acid. And then we add in water in here as an entrainer for extractive distillation, where on the top we get the methyl acetate and water that we recycle back again into the reactor, whereas on the bottom in here methanol and water we get as the other output. Okay, then we have this dehydration column that separate the methanol and water, whereas in here we have another dehydration column that will separate the water and acetic acid. The things that I took from this book is taken from the book of Louis Ben. It's called The Plane-Wide Process Control. It came from 90, 99. In Malaysia, we don't have much expert in the process control. So because most of the people that are doing research in the process, on the process side in chemical process in Malaysia, in here are the one that are doing process integration, process optimization. Mostly the one that have the research in the process design and control are the one that are educated in US. Most of the famous people in Malaysia in here, they normally took their PhD and their in UK, I think, UK and Europe. That's why most of them are going into the process optimization and integration. So now I think one of your senior, one of them is going into the process design and control. So reactor can be divided into various types. So you can have a CSTR, you can have a tubular, packed bed, leaders bed, sparge, slurry, trickle bed. Okay. Whereas for the separation, you can have a different unit operation. You can have a distillation, evaporation, filtration, crystallization, liquid-liquid extraction, absorption, pressure swing, absorption. This one you have been introduced to in my week one, process modeling and optimizations, right, if you remember. So this one is normally being used to separate gas components. It's the attractive thing about the chemical engineer is the thing that we design, even though we cannot see the form of whatever we design. So for example, it's very interesting, right? That a chemical engineer can design the pressure swing adsorption, even though we cannot really see oxygen or nitrogen. So for example, they are abstract, where you cannot see the form of the oxygen and nitrogen, right? And also, you can separate the helium as well from the natural gas, even though you cannot see helium, right? That's what I go back and talk to the people, why we are being proud as a chemical engineer is because we design those things that people cannot see. Unlike civil engineer, for example, civil engineer, you can see. You have the beam, you have the construction over there. What they do is they measure the mechanical strength. They can measure, for example, how much of the steel beams is needed, okay, and then what kind of the configurations of the steel beam that you need in order for you to be able to sustain this much weight. For chemical engineer, we don't necessarily have to see, but we are able to design the performance for that particular process or for that particular systems to achieve the production. So that's are something that sets apart chemical engineers from the other engineers. Okay, guys, the thing that are quite interesting in here is the difference between the adsorption and the adsorption. Okay, absorption in here is based on the bulk system, whereas adsorption here is based on the surface. So you need to be able to recognize this as early as possible. Adsorption is very different with absorption. Okay, so if you go and ask me, for example, you see, if I ask you, can you tell me an example of absorption in your daily life? What will you tell me? Or for example, Taha, Usman, Tiffany, Clarence, you want to try? What kind of application did you see adsorption in your daily life? Anybody knows? Guys, you are on your third year. You need to know this much more because you are a chemical engineer and you will absorption, not absorption. Absorption. This one is too many. You know already. But this one, what kind of example that you have seen in your daily life, absorption? Anybody wants to try? No? Nobody? The simple example is the activated carbon. The humidifications is, that could be, Clarence? That may be one of the application of absorption. Yeah, good try. The easiest one will be activated carbon. If you have a stomach ache, okay? you take that activated carbon pill, you go to the pharmacy, you take that activated, the black activated carbon, it's called Norit, okay, Norit or another thing, activated carbon, is being packed into a black pack. They pack it very, but you can grind that black things and it becomes a powdery stuff, black. The powdery stuff in there is an activated carbon, which is have a very large surface area. So the surface area can be thousands meter square per gram, okay? So what will happen is that once you put in the thing into your stomach, in your stomach you have a liquid phase, okay? That powder in there is basically will all the pollutants or all the components that will attach into that black powder, because that powder has a very large surface area per gram. So meaning, because of that large surface area, that large surface area will be the one where the pollutants attach into that surface area. So if you can imagine that this is a surface, okay, the component will attach into that particular surface area, because it has a very large surface area, it will take many pollutants. So all the pollutants will be attached into the surface of that particular component, of that particular powder of the activated carbon. So the larger the surface of that thing, the more effective that it can attach all these compounds. But it works based on the surface. Yes, in some part in the, it's mostly like a filter actually, Alvin. It's not really like a, it mostly like a filter. It works like a membrane, I think. Okay, but the pressure sweep absorption is working based on that particular principle as well. Okay, so now we go and move on into the next one again. So now the integrated process is the thing that are particular about this plant wide crop control is that odor remover can be absorption as well. That's correct, Jason. Yep. Odor remover, that depends, because you have some compound that basically sublime, so it also change from the solid into a gas, and you have something else again that basically absorb, so that thing absorb also the everything like the odor, then that work by absorption as well. That's correct. So the thing that are important in plant wide control is the recycle stream and energy integration. So that's why these three things are very important, because if you have a change in the temperature and thermal conditions, then that may propagate into the suppression section. Okay, if you have a change in terms of the flow rate in the reactor, it may be recycled back again, and it may create another problem as well. It can propagate, and then you have the change in the stream composition that it can alter the suppression requirements. So this is the essence of why you need to consider the entire plant's control system, because in the real situations you have the material recycle, okay, and then you have the effect of the energy integrations, and then you also need to account for the chemical component inventories within your system. And chemical engineers, we all know that why we need the material recycle, because we cannot just throw away the reactants that has not been reacting before, okay? We cannot do that thing because of the cost. So chemical engineer has to work in order to make sure that the process give the investor profit. Otherwise, we will not be able to get a job, okay? If we don't, we will not able to do that thing. So the reason for the material cycle is all that is given in here. The energy integration is also important, because it's being done to improve the thermodynamic efficiency, and in here is basically showing a toluene hydrodealkylation process in here, that the heat from the reactor is used in reboiler for all three distillation column. So you go and check in here, reboiler in here, okay, they are being recycled around. From here you see this is a heat exchanger is being used to heat the reboiler on this column, and then go up in here again, And then in here is also being used to heat the reboiler in here. And then the one in here is being used to heat the reboiler in here. And we always have to use a level control as well in the direction of the flow. So these are the example if for one configuration. Let's say that we have a two distillation column. This one is a simple distillation column that are connected in series without any material recycle in here. The specification in here is being determined by this upstream unit. So what we control in here is the flow control, the flow rate into the distillation column. Because we are controlling this flow control in here, sometimes in certain cases, we may be able to get the disturbances from this upstream process. So what essentially we control is here in is the level, the level control in terms the inventory in our column in here by controlling the output flow into the next column. So if our disturbance coming from the upstream, generally what we control is the outlet stream. Okay, you can see in here, this is the outlet stream. And then this is also control the outlet stream. In here as well, in terms of the condenser, also control the outlet stream, control the outlet stream. This is something that we call an inventory control loop. So the first thing that you need to have in your control systems is the inventory. We need to control how much liquid we need to maintain within our column, within our reactors, within our tank. That is the so-called inventory control systems. Okay, that will be the first stage that you need to do, the inventory control systems. After the inventory control system is taken care of, then you go into the regulatory control systems for the performance of your reactor and your distillation column. Because obviously you cannot let this liquid level to totally dry, right? You have to make sure that at least the liquid level control in the liquid level in here is the liquid is still stay in here, okay? And it will not basically go up to the level where it is flooded as well. So this one is continued. If the plant is set up for an on-demand production, so instead if you are working for a plant where the outlet is being determined, so this may be the one that are being changed. So depending, for example, at certain time, you want to have a certain rate of the production. Okay, so you're controlling the flow control in here. Meaning, whatever the disturbance that come in here, it will be propagated into the upstream units. So in this particular case, what is controlled is the liquid level control is controlled by the inlet. So this, since this one is being controlled, the outlet of the system is being controlled, then what will be controlling the liquid level is the one that is going in, the inlet stream in here, and the inlet stream in here. For the condenser part in these things, the control will remain the same in here. Okay, because this is based on the productions of the A and B as well in here. Okay, so you need to check and go and look into this. Basically everything that later on when you want to make a process plan design, you need to decide whether you want to set the production rate at the front end of the process, or you want to set up the plan based on the on-demand production. Depending on the conditions that you want to set, whether you want to set the production rate at the front end of the process, or if you want to set up the plan production based on the on-demand production rate, the way that you set up the control systems will be different. Did everybody get it up to this point clearly? Before I continue into the other point, this is very important, eh? Because I think this was not given before in the control unit last year. And you can see these things as well, for example. So if you notice in here, you are controlling the level based on the outlet. Okay, this in here you are controlling this one is the liquid level of the reboiler in here is controlled by the outlet, right? And then in here, the liquid, the level controller in here, this one is being controlled by the is being controlled by the makeup in here. Okay, because the you see that this one is the production rate in is basically determined in the upstream. Okay, but in here we are adding a slightly different controller systems in here. So this one is the ratio control, and then this one is the liquid, is the level control. So the ratio control in here will also determine the level control in here as well. Okay, so this one is being tailed with these things in here. So it's being coupled with the makeup things that goes back into your extractive distillation column in here. So whatever essentially that comes out from here, in here, is regulated by the that is returned back into recycled back into this column and in here, is being passed through the flow control. So we will discuss later on why we bother to use this flow control in here to determine this because we want to avoid the so-called snowball effect in the control system. Okay, you need to go back into here again and check. And this is because the presence of the recycle stream in the real process makes the control problem much more complex compared to the two situations shown before. Remember that in here we have nothing that are being recycled back into your reactor. So this one is very simple. So if later on you design a system where there is no recycle, then it becomes very simple because you don't have anything that is recycled in the system. But if you have any recycle system, then this will make your control structure becomes more complicated. Okay, because the presence of the recycle stream alters the plant's dynamic and steady state behavior. Recycle has an impact on the dynamics of the process. So the overall time constant can be much different than the sum of the time constant. And recycle can give you a snowball effect. Because a small change in the throughput or the feed composition can lead to a large change in steady state recycle stream flow rates. Okay. This snowball effect is being termed by Prof. Leuben. He's the one that basically come up with the first original research paper on this snowball effect that was about 1990, I think, when not many people recognize this effect. Okay, this is something that we call the high sensitivity of the recycled flow rates to small disturbances. So this can be tackled if you make an important if you are somebody who are trained in terms of the control structure, then you will be able to somehow avoid this snowball effect. Okay, then how do you do that thing? Snowball effect can be prevented by applying the following plant-wide control heuristic. A stream somewhere in each liquid recycles loop should be flow controlled. So if I show you these things in here from the review paper of your senior, okay, we are controlling the flow of the recycled material in here. You see, this is being controlled. Okay, so what is controlling in here is basically the flow control from this feed in here. Whatever the feed control in here, this will be compared with the ratio. In terms of the ratio, whatever that comes in here, it will be compared with whatever that comes in here. So the flow rate of this solvent that comes back into this EDC1 is gonna be compared with this feed that comes in, and that will determine how much of this flow rate that will be allowed to be recycled back into these things in here. So in this regard, we are basically limiting the amount of the recycle stream that will be put into the back into the distillation column, into these two distillation column in here. And this one is further being controlled again by the flow controller again in here that use the ratio of whatever comes in from here with whatever that is being put in here. Does it look complicated, guys? What do you think of this? Is it complicated? And this is something that we call the common inventory control structure for ternary isotropic mixture. So at least you need to know at least this much if you want to be able to design a process plan. If you are not, then later on you will have an accident in your plan. That will be dangerous for you. Right? Then you will ask, what, sir, how did you know the snowball effect? Because look at this particular example, okay? In here we have an example of the reaction that where A become irreversibly become B. We have a fresh feed FO and ZO. In here, our reactor is consisting of a liquid phase reactor. So this is something that is simple. And we have a distillation column and we have a reboiler in here where the product B is coming in here. And then the distillate product is returning back into your reactor. So basically the distillate in here is containing mostly your A, whereas your B will come up in the bottom. This is what the system that Louis Ben used to illustrate the snowball effect. Okay, so we will explore two alternative control structure for this process. Okay, so the first one is with the fixed reactor holdup. So the fresh flow rate is controlled. This one is controlled. The reactor level is controlled by manipulating reactor effluent flow. So in here we let the liquid control to determine this flow in here. So what we control in here is the liquid level in here. So if whatever comes in is bigger, then the outlet in here will have to be adjusted to be bigger in order for the liquid level to be constant. You get it, guys? And then what happens in here is that we also liquid level control is also put in here in order for us to maintain the liquid level in here such that we have a constant liquid level in here so that our XB in here will change according to maintain the liquid control in here. Okay, so the problem that we see in here is that we have liquid level control in here, we have a liquid level control in here, so everything in the recycle loop is basically set by the level control. The column pressure in here is of course controlled by manipulating the coolant flow rate to the condenser in here. Okay, so what's the problem with these things? So this is a conventional control structure where the flow of the fresh reactant is used to regulate the plant production rate. However, there is no flow controller anywhere in the recycle loop. So the flow around the loop are set based on the Yupon level control in the reactor and in the reflux drum in here, because whatever we recycle back is the distillate in here, which is the A that return back to the reactor. The problem in here is we will have a snowball effect to take place when this control structure is used. How do we know that thing? Then what we even use in here is basically a simple mass balance. So at any particular points in this reactor, what he did is he is using a mass balance to illustrate the different scenario. Okay, so this is the base case fresh compositions at 0.9 mole fraction of A. Okay, so he calculate what will happen if the fresh feed compositions becomes 0.8 mole fraction of A. Therefore, the recycled flow rate will be decreased to this 205. However, when the fresh feed composition is pure A, then this one will increase to 330 moles per hour. Therefore, just a 25% change in disturbance. So imagine that in the beginning you have 0.8, but if you change, suddenly there is a disturbance. The fresh feed compositions becomes pure A, okay? Then your recycle flow changed so much from 205 to 330. Therefore, you have a very large change in terms of the recycle flow of 60% if you are adopting this control structure. So then you may never think about these things because this is the first time that you go into this plant wide process control. But the thing is, you can only go into these things only if you really analyze the systems in a very specific way. Okay, so that this one is the effect of the fresh feed composition. You can also do the mass balance for the effect of the fresh feed flow. So if that change into, if this is 260.5, then if you change it to 215, then the recycle flow drops to 187. However, when you change it to 265, then the recycle flow must increase to 362. Therefore, a 23% of change will result in 94% change in recycle flow rate. So this will be a disaster for the process to be adjusted. So snowball effect will happen for this particular control structure. So what happens if the snowball effect will change? So because these things is happening and goes to here, this will affect the separation section, because the separation section must handle whatever that comes out from the reactor, right? So this will translate to a significant change in the composition of the feed stream into the separation section, which will change the lot of the separation section significantly, hence producing large variation in the recycle flow rates. Okay, so I think I will continue the discussions again on this on the control structure for the one that can handle this snowball effect in the next lecture. I think I'll stop it up to here now because it's already 1 hour and 6 minutes. So everybody get it clear up to this point. Anything that you want to ask regarding the transfer function or the plant wide control, or is it really a heavy materials guide to handle for this process control? Any questions? Too much? Alvin, Amanda, Clarence, Daniel, James, Jason, Jonathan, Chising, Michael, Taha, Usman, Rachel, Selena, Shafaf, Tiffany, Yusi, Wong Yo, Weixing. I'm just sorry if this material is a bit tough, but there is no choice for me sometimes, because I have to try to educate such that I can get the chemical engineers to in the future, because otherwise if I only give you the easy materials and the theory, then you guys will have difficulties in the future to really no you cannot. The recycle has to be applied. That's why you have to be able to design the proper control structure that will be able to eliminate the effect of the disturbances. That's what I'm showing you in this particular paper. That's how people are doing it. They use these things. This is a common inventory control structure for the ternary azeotropic mixture. That's why you have this flow control integrated into your recycle control loop. And also you have another control flow control system that is being used in here. But in here, they are using somehow an advanced control systems that use a ratio control in here, okay? And also in here as well. So if you really want to go into the research deep into the process control, that will be an entirely different thing. So you have to really specialize and spend too much time. But what I'm trying to give you in here is an understanding whether that you know that such an effect exists. So that as a chemical engineer, if you see this kind of scenario, you would be able to prevent, or you would be able to put in a flow control in the recycle stream such that you don't have the disastrous effect into your design. Okay, did you understand what I'm trying to give you in here? I don't want you to go into details, but I need you to be aware that such snowball effect exists. So you need to pay attention into these things in your design, right? What do you mean by if the performance is above 90%? Is it still Probably not, Jason. But when will you have that kind of system that can perform above 90%? I would say probably only one in 100 probably that can have a performance above 90%. Because to me, I think all the chemical reactions are not ideal in nature, right? Guys, you agree with me? If we have such a simple systems, then we don't need to recycle everything. It is possible, but it's very rare. That's what your takeaway from this. Okay, guys, if there is no nothing else again, then I'll let you digest and I will upload the things in here. And hopefully you guys get much from the lecture, and don't forget that I still have some time to remind you again, I think, before you get your online quiz this Saturday, right? Okay, have a good evening, guys, and see you again tomorrow. I will try to continue again on these things, but hopefully you guys are okay. Stay well. See you again tomorrow. Bye for now. Let me stop the recording.